Welcome back, guys. This is part 5 of our C programming tutorial video series. In this part of the video, I'm going to tell you how to read input from keyboard in a C program. More specifically, we'll be learning about this scanf function in C. Okay, then, let's begin. Let's first see the importance of importance of taking input from the user. I mean, why we might need to take any input from the user. Okay, so let's first try to understand the problem, and then we'll be learning like how we can make use of this scanf function to solve this problem. So for that reason, let's say we have to write this program. We have to write write a program to add two numbers and display their sum on the screen. So this is the program that we have to write. Now for that reason, see, we have to add two numbers. The type of the numbers are not specified. So what I'll assume is that the numbers are integer numbers that we have to add. Okay. So for that reason, I'll be creating two containers, A and B. In the container A, I'll be storing the first number. In container B, I'll be storing the second number. And also, say, we want to store the sum in a third container. So for that reason, I'm creating this third container, C. Done. Now we have created these containers. What is the next task? We have created three containers. The next task is to store in the first container the first number that we want to add. The second container, there we have to store the second number that we want to add. And in the third container, we have to store the sum of these first two containers. So let's do it. Say for example, in the first container, we want to store the number 20. In the second container, we want to store the number 30. And then in the third container, we'll be storing the sum of these numbers A and B. Some of the values which are there in container A and B, we want to store it in C. Okay? So see this thing here. These plus and equal symbol, these are operators. Okay? I didn't say anything about these operators till now. And that I'll be doing it in most probably the next video or next to next video. Okay? So, but since these two operators are very simple, that's why I'm using it. Okay? So, don't need to worry about them. I'll be explaining you how you can make use of these operators at different situations. Okay? But for the time being, what you just need to know is that writing this way, what it will do is it will first compute the sum of these variables A and B and will store the result in this variable C. That's what it will do. Okay, for the time being, I guess that much is enough. And that's quite, evident also from this writing. And that's the beauty of high-level programming language, actually. The things are very much, close to natural language. Okay. So, okay, anyhow, so we found the sum and we stored the sum in the variable C. Now our task is to display the sum on the screen. So you can display it in any way you want. I mean, anywhere you want, in the sense like in any sentence you want. So I'll be displaying the sum as, say, for example, sum is percentage D, comma. And then see here, I have used one format specifier here, so of type integer. So here I have to specify an integer number. And what number it is, we want to display the sum, so it should come from the from the container C. So that way it will display whatever it is there in the container C, that will be displayed here in this place. So as a result, you'll be seeing sum is some number, which is basically the content of the container C, which is nothing but the sum of the containers A and B, which is nothing but 50. So if you run this code, you'll be seeing, okay, the sum is 50. That's coming on the screen. So the program is right here, right? Now, the main problem with this, although the code is right, logic is right, everything is right about this program more or less, only one problem with this program. The problem is that if you execute this program again and again, every time you execute this program, what it is going to do is it is always going to show you the same output, sum is 50. This program, although it knows how to add two numbers, the problem with this program is that it always assumes the numbers to be 20 and 30. And why it is so? Because we have hard-coded these numbers as the value of this variable A and B. That's why. So if you suppose you want to add two other different numbers, so in that case, and you want to make use of this program for that purpose, so what you have to do is you have to go to the source code of the program and you have to change those numbers. Say for example, now I want to add the numbers 90 and 30. So that for that reason, what I have to go is I have to go to the source code, I have to change the value of the variable A to 90, say value of the variable will remain 30, And then I have to execute the program, and that way it will give me the output 90 plus 30 is equal to 120. So you got the point. Now, every time we want to add two different numbers, we have to go to the source code of the program and we have to change the values of these two variables A and B to whatever the numbers that we want to add. Certainly, that's quite, you know, that's certainly is not, not a convenient way of doing the thing, isn't it? Because that's how things doesn't work. I mean, you don't modify the source code, actually, right? So it would have been better, like, if whenever you execute the program, actually the program itself asks the user to type something from the keyboard. Whatever the user types from the keyboard, those things the program can take and now store in these two variables A and B in some way. So it would have been nice, and we can actually do that, and we can do that thing with the help of a scanf function. Now let's first see some basic details about this scanf function, and then we'll be using scanf function to overcome this problem. And what is the problem? That if every time you execute the program, we, instead of assuming this A and B to be 90 and 30, in the program will actually ask the user, okay, you specify for this particular run, what should be the value of A? For this particular run, what should be the value of B? So that way, once the user specified the numbers, it will tell us what is the sum of those two numbers. Okay? Okay, then. Let's first talk about these scanf function briefly. The general syntax of writing this scanf function is like this. So scanf is a inbuilt function. So you'll be writing scanf this way, as you know, like, you cannot write capital S and all this stuff. I already have told you, right? So scanf, you have to write all of them are lowercase, scanf, this is the function. And here inside this scanf function, two things you have to specify. The first thing is a string of format specifiers. If things are not clear, don't worry, huh? I'll be explaining you. Specifiers. And then, see here, I'm writing a string of format specifiers. That is, you have to specify a string of format specifier. You have to write those things within this double quotation. And as part of the syntax, you have to put a comma here. And after putting the comma, you have to specify here a list of addresses, okay? Addresses. A list of addresses of variables. Now, don't worry, you know? Don't worry about this term, like, what is these addresses? How do I get it? I mean, doesn't it sound like very much technical or something? No, don't worry. I mean, no, the scanf function is, you just have to specify those things. The C program allows you to actually specify addresses in a very easy way. You will be learning about that, okay, in a moment. So this is the general syntax of writing a scanf function. Now, first, let's see here this part, like this format specifier. I talked about these format specifiers in the previous part of the video. So part 4, I guess, in this video series. So here I want to tell you one thing, guys. You please subscribe the channel and subscribe this playlist and see the playlist from the beginning. Like, you know, these videos are created keeping in mind that the viewers will look at the video, the viewers will go through the video in a sequence, okay? So at any particular point, any particular video, it will be assumed that the viewers already have seen the, you know, have gone through the previous content or previous part of the videos. So although I try to keep the content more or less independent, but then also sometimes, now, by nature, I might have to actually refer to some of the previous concepts that I discussed in some of the previous videos, okay? So for that reason, it's a request for you people, like, if you just give some time, devote some time to learn these C programming thing. Once you learn it, once you spend your, like, say, 10, 15 hours, it will remain with you always, okay? It will be good investment, I'm telling you guys. So please do that. But anyhow, say a string of format specifiers. Now, what are these format specifiers? Even if I have told you these things already, but then also, let me write it here one more time. So for basic data types, like for integer, the format specifier is %d. For character, the format specifier is %c. For float, the format specifier is %f. And for long float, for double, double the format specifier is %lf. These are the format specifiers. So we now know, like, a string of format specifiers means you just have to write, you know, format specifiers, that's all, okay, within double quotations. So, and we know the format specifiers. Now the question is the list of addresses of variables. What is this and how do you specify it in a scanf function? Okay, for that reason, let's see this thing actually. Say for example, you have created a container, say integer A, in this fashion, okay, and another container, say for example integer B. Two containers you have created. So if you have followed my videos, again I'm referring to some of my previous videos, so if you have followed those videos, then you know that what these two statements or what these two instructions will do in the RAM. In the RAM somewhere it will create. Now how I ask you people to consider this RAM? Yes, the idea is like, you know, this RAM is nothing but it is a big hotel of you know, where a lot of rooms are there, and in each room, these are the rooms of the hotel, you know, these are the rooms, and each room you can store, you can put only a zero, either a zero or you can put a one. Okay, now each room, the analogy with hotel, why am I bringing that analogy here, is that the way in a hotel each room has a number, the same way here also in the RAM each of these memory location has a number, each of this particular cell has a number, okay, that number is called actually the address of that particular memory location. Say it starts from room number zero, so you can think it like this: this is room number zero, room number one, room number two, room number three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, like that it goes on. Okay, now that you know, now you see integer A, whenever you write integer A, as I said, no, integer means you can assume 16 bits, continuous 16 bits together, that is a integer container. So if here you are creating a container whose name is A and of type integer. So what it will do is 16 consecutive bits, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then 12, then 16. So these 16 bits, these 16 bits together, it will be assigned as, or it will be considered as a container. And that container will be called as this A. Now see, the address of the first bit, the address of the first bit is actually, or the when I say address, it means what? The room number. You know the hotel analogy? The first, all these 16 rooms are, these are booked against the same person. Okay? So the address of the person in this hotel will be the starting room number. Okay? So the same, if you follow the analogy now, the thing is, the address of this variable will be the number of this first bit out of those 16 bits. Okay, so that is called as the address of the variable A. You got the point? So it's just the room number. Whenever you say it is an address of a variable, it is like, whenever you say it's a variable, what do you know? Whenever it say it's a variable, it means that it represents a continuous fixed number of bits based on the type of the variable. If it is integer 16 bits, if it is character 8 bits, if it is floating point number, then it is like 32 bits. So that way, so whenever it is a variable, it is a container basically of a certain width, of a certain number of bits, right? So the starting bit number in the RAM, so these bits are there in the RAM, so in the RAM, whatever it is the starting bit number, that is actually the address of that particular variable. Got the point? Now, in C program, don't worry, again, even if things are not clear, you don't need to worry at all, okay? So, why? You will come to know in a moment. Now, you see, we know more or less what is an address. It is the starting bit number of that particular variable, right? Now, in C program, whenever you want to know the address of something, whenever you want, how do you know, or how do you get, you means what, as a programmer, okay, how do you get the address of a variable? How do you get the address of a variable in C? That is your question, right? I mean, because if you want to make use of scanf, then here you have to specify only the, see here, I didn't write here list of variables. Okay, if it is only list of variables, then things are easy. I mean, you can directly write the name of these variables here, right? But I wrote here like list of addresses of variables. It means not the variables you have to specify here. What you have to specify is you have to specify the addresses of those variables. So obvious question is that how then in a C program we can get the address of a variable? If you know the answer for that question, then you know. You are ready to write this scanf function. And that's quite simple, actually. You just have to write something like this. This ampersand operator and the name of the variable. Name of the variable means here, let me write it in a general way. Ampersand operator and then name of the variable. So that's how you get the address of whatever the name of the variable you write, you will get the address of that variable just by writing this ampersand symbol in front of the variable name. That's all you have to do. Now see, this address issue, the address of a variable, it is actually called as a pointer. And the concept of pointer in C programming is a very important concept. Okay, without pointers, it's like most of the efficient programs or professional programs that you'll be writing in C programming, using C programming language, there you must have to use this concept of pointers, okay? But this concept of pointer usually comes towards the end of the learning process. Before actually knowing the concept of pointers, you have to know a whole lot of other things there in C programming, okay? So that is the reason I said you don't need to worry if you are like not very much comfortable with the concept of addresses. So for the time being, only one thing you need to know, and that is how to get the address of a variable in C program. That's all that you need to know right now. And that I told you, actually, you just have to make use of this ampersand symbol, particular symbol ampersand, called as ampersand, in front of the name of a variable to know or to indicate that you are actually not talking about the variable. You are talking about the address of the variable. Okay, get it? Okay, done. Now we know, like now we see here, the general syntax of scanf is like a string of format specifiers. We know the format specifiers, and then also we have to specify a list of addresses of variables. So we know how to get the address of a particular variable in C. I told you this thing here, right? So that way we know both these two components then. Then let's now see an example, and that way you will understand how you can use this scanf function. Okay, now say for example, I declare here this variable here once again. Say this is your integer a, and I want to see if I want to store 9 in this variable, I can write directly 9 here. But this time I do not want that. What I want is I want the value of this variable a to be specified by the user. Every time the user executes the program, it asks, it should take the input from the user actually, okay? So for that reason, we know, we already have learned till now that we have to make use of this scanf function. So I'm writing here scanf. And then you see what we have to specify. Within double quotation, you have to specify a string of format specifiers, okay? So how do you do that? So within double quotation, you have to specify a string of format specifier means here, I want to take only one input from the user, so I'll be writing scanf only 1% d. That's all. Now it is a string. See here, this is the string of format specifiers. And then you will put a comma as part of the syntax. And then what you have to specify? You have to specify here list of addresses of variables. Here you have to see here, whenever you take something from the keyboard, that something should go. This is the thing happening actually. See, you read this scanf function. This scanf function, it reads something from the keyboard. It reads the input from the keyboard, and then obviously after reading the input, it has to store the input which is specified by the user somewhere, and that somewhere you have to specify here, and that somewhere is address of the variable a. It means what? Whatever the user type from the keyboard, from this format specifier, the program will know, okay, whatever it is the user types from the keyboard, it has to interpret that thing as a integer number. That's why I have written here percentage d. See here, I want to accept an integer number from the keyboard. So that's why I'm writing here a percentage D here. Okay, so that's the meaning of this particular format specifier here. Whatever the user types from the keyboard, it will be interpreted as an integer. Done. That is the first step. And not only interpreting it as integer, also what it will do is that integer, whatever it is that user types, that integer will go to where? It will go to the memory location, or it will actually go as the content of the variable A. Whatever you type from the keyboard, that will be interpreted as an integer, and that integer will become the value of this variable A. Okay, then you might be thinking, why do I need to like specify the address? Why didn't simply A? Yeah, it would have worked, but you know, the C programming language, it is the part of the syntax of the C programming language. It is developed in that way. Okay, the rules of C programming language are that way. So for that reason, it is in this way. Okay, in other programming languages, even in C++, you don't have to specify these, you know, the address of a particular variable to store, you know, the input from the user in that variable. But since it is the part of the syntax, you have to stick with it, okay? And it is not a big job, isn't it? The only thing is that instead of writing this, the name of the variable, you also have to write this particular symbol in front of this variable. That's all. But, you know, as a programmer, you should know, like, what it is doing is, it is actually, you know, giving, it is actually, here, these two combinedly mean the address of the variable A. So this particular symbol, although you can read it as ampersand, in general we call it ampersand or the and symbol, but here specifically in terms of programming, C programming, you'll be reading this symbol as address of, okay? So now you see how you'll read this scanf statement, scanf percentage D and then address of the variable A. Address of this ampersand symbol, you'll read it as address of and then A. Okay, that's what these list of addresses means here. Now you see, when you execute this program, what will happen is this program will wait for the user to type something from the keyboard, and until and unless the user types something from the keyboard and presses enter, it will always wait for the user actually. So the program will not go down, it will not proceed further until and unless this particular instruction is over. If it is not clear, again, when you see some examples, you will come to know. But for the time being, what I wanted to tell you is this. This is like, if you want, this is, A is a variable and you want to read the value of this variable. A is a variable of type integer. You want to read the value of this variable from the keyboard. So in that case, you'll be writing the scanf statement in this way. Okay? Okay, got it, I guess. Now, just one more example and done. Now, you will be ready to write code. Say, for example, you have another variable, say, integer B, and you have another variable, say, for example, float C, okay? So, in this case, suppose, now you want to take both the value of B and C from the keyboard. So, you can do something like this. Scanf, see, suppose, for example, first you want to take this integer. So, you'll be writing, you want to accept one integer, and you want to store the integer somewhere. And after accepting the integer, suppose you want to accept another floating point number. See, I didn't write any comma or anything, okay? So you just have to specify what are the things that you want to accept. First, you want to accept from the keyboard an integer. Second, you want to accept from the keyboard a floating point number. That's why I have written here percentage D and percentage F. See, remember, I didn't write any comma or anything here. See, this is a string you are writing, okay? And that string should, in case of scanf, that string should contain only format specifiers, nothing else. Remember this thing. Only format specifiers, nothing else. Nothing else in the sense, no comma, no space, nothing. Only the format specifiers you'll be specifying. Don't get confused with the printf statement. Printf is what? Displaying something on the screen. So for that reason, whatever it is that you want to display, you will be writing within the double quotation. Scanf tasks, the task of scanf function is not to display something on the screen. Okay? Its only task is to read something from the keyboard. So what are the information you have to specify while reading something from the keyboard is only what, how many input it should take from the keyboard and how it should interpret those inputs. That's all. So moral of the story is that within this double quotation in scanf, within this double quotation, you will not be writing anything other than these format specifiers. I'll show you some example whether you can write syntax wise, it is not wrong, okay? But logically, if you consider, it will be wrong. So for that reason, just make sure that you don't write anything within this in this format specifier string. You will only specify the format specifiers, that's all, one after another, okay, without any comma, without any space, that's all. So percentage d, percentage f, here I'm writing, see, for example, I want to take this b and c from the keyboard, and the first number I want to take is integer, so I'm writing here first percentage d, second number I want to take from the keyboard is this floating point number, so I'm writing here percentage f, done. So we specified what how many we want to accept and in what format we want to accept, right? That is done. Now where we want to store these numbers, so as part of this syntax you'll be writing here a comma, and then this integer where you want to go, this integer you want to go at the address of the variable b, and then comma, this floating point number you want to go at the address of the variable c, that's all. And then close the this parenthesis here, and then put the semicolon as part of the syntax. Your scanf is ready. Got it? So that is the story of writing a scanf statement. Now let's write some actual code and make our understanding concrete and sort of permanent. Okay? Okay guys, then let's begin. So here is this program and we want it. Now we leave this space, half an hour back, we didn't know actually how to take the input from the user for these variables a and b. Now see, after half an hour we enhance ourselves, we now know like how to take input from the user, right? Now let this a be 90, let this b be 30, don't worry, now we want to take input from the user. So for that reason we'll be writing scanf, and okay, let me ask you one question here, okay? Should I erase these 90 and 30 before actually writing this scanf function? Let me know it in the comment section. Keeping these values, a is equal to 90, b is equal to 30, will it have any side effect on the program? Let me know it in the comment section. If it is yes, then why? And if it is no, then why? Okay? I'd like to know. Scanf, and then here, suppose I want to take both these a and b and one after another. First I want to take an integer, both of these a and b's are integers, so first number is an integer I want to accept, second number is also an integer I want to accept, and then the first number should go at the address of the variable a, the second number should go at the address of the variable b, none, and that's all. Now let's execute this program and see what happens. Okay, now run this program and check the output. Now you might be thinking, what is happening? The output screen is sort of, no, nothing is coming. Is the program wrong or something? No, actually the program is not wrong. What the program is doing, you see, when you execute this program, let me show you what happens when you execute this program. Okay, this is your program, right? And let me make some space here. Okay, now you know the program will be executed from main line by line, and these comments will be skipped. So for that reason, the first line that will be executed is int abc. So the first line is int abc, so that particular line will do what? It will make the program to create some containers there in the RAM. So somewhere conjugative 16 bits will be, conjugative sub 16 bits will be assigned, will be booked for these, and those 16 bits will be assigned to the variable A. It means those 16 bits combinedly, that container will be given a name, say A, okay? And then similarly, somewhere this, the container B, which is nothing but conjugative 16 bits, that will be called as B. And somewhere another container will be created, C, conjugative 16 bits. Now this, whether they are 16 bits or 32 bits, that might be a confusion. I'll come to that point. But for the time being, for simplicity, I'm saying you that integer means 16 bits, okay? So C, 16 bits will be allocated, and that container will be called as C. That part is done. ABC means this thing will be done in the memory. And then a is equal to 90. When you write a equal to 90, here the binary representation of 90 will be stored. So as a whole, I can write 90 is stored in this container. B is equal to 30. So here 30 will be stored in the container. And then now see, when you execute this program up to this point, no problem. All these things are created and then a 90, b 30 is stored. Then suppose this is your output screen now, okay? Now this is your output screen. After execution of this line, is done, created all these three containers, and then A90 done, B30 done, and then next instruction is this scanf function. Now what this scanf function is waiting for you, what this scanf function does, it will simply wait for the user to type something from the keyboard. It will show you the screen, and there it will just wait there, okay? Now, okay, the user will come and the user will type some number there, and I'll read those numbers and I'll store those numbers in this variable A and B. So if you execute the program, now the program will, and from this point onwards, until and unless you type anything from the keyboard, it will not move forward. It will not execute this line C is equal to A plus B. It will not execute this line sum is percentage D, and it will not execute this line return 1. It means these three lines of the program will be executed only when you complete giving your input from the keyboard. Only when you release the program from the waiting state, where it was actually waiting for the user to type two numbers there, because you have written here 2% is these, so it will wait for the user to enter two numbers, and then only it will proceed with these following instructions. You get the point? You got the idea now why the output of the program is looking like this here? It is actually doing the thing. Up to this point it has done, and due to this scanf statement here, it is just waiting there for the user to actually type two numbers there. Now it is the question of, now you understood, okay, here actually you have to type some numbers. Now the question is, here you have to type two numbers, and how you're going to type two numbers? Suppose I wanted 12 and 34. So how do you do that? So only writing 12, 34 is not going to work. So what you can do is, you can write 12 space 34 and then you can press enter, or what you can do is, you can enter the number one by one. That is, you can write 12 enter, 34 enter, like that. So let me take this other approach, 12 enter. If I write 12 and if I press enter, still it will be waiting for you to enter the other number, because you see here you were written the you as a programmer, you wrote like 2% is this there. It means the program, as it always obeys you, by obeying the programmer, it will actually wait there again. It will again wait there silently. Now I'm waiting for the other number. You please enter the other number. Okay, then you entered, suppose, other number as 54. As soon as you press enter, this scanf will be over, because two numbers, it will, as soon as I press enter, so it will receive two numbers. The first number will, this 12 already has gone to A. Now this second number, 54, it will go to B. Okay, once I press enter, this instruction will be over, and immediately it will execute C equal to A plus B, and then it will display the sum on the screen. Okay, let's see. I'm pressing enter at the count of 3. 1, 2, 3. Sum is 66 coming on the screen. You got the point? Yes? Yes. Okay. Now, that's all then. Like, if you have understood up to this point, then you have understood actually how to take input from the user. Now, say for example, now you have not integer numbers, you have floating point numbers. Then how will you take it? Say instead of these, these numbers are not like A, B, C are not integers, they're floating points. So in that case, you just have to change this format specifier from integer to float, display this as a float, and done. You run the program, run the code, and enter the number, run the code, enter the number here, 12, enter 34. Although I have entered integer here, they will be, interpreted as floating point numbers. I'll press enter. The sum is 46.00000. Suppose I want these, after the decimal, I want only three digits. So I'll be writing here 0.3f. Okay. I run the code. I enter again some number, 12 and 45. Sum is 57.000. Or again, I run the code. I enter the number as 12.43. Enter. And 23.78. Enter. The sum is 36.210. Got it? Clear? Okay. So that's how we take input from the user. Now one last point let me tell you here. Not last point, a few more points I have to tell you, but quite straightforward. Don't worry actually, okay? Yeah. If I execute this program, you see here, there is a problem. All, you know, although it is not a logical problem, it is not a syntax problem. I mean, it's a sort of a logical problem, okay? It's not, certainly it's not a syntax problem. It's a logical problem. Even you cannot call it as a logical problem. It is just a, you know, convenience issue. Why is it so? You see, okay, here, no, my face will come up to this point. Right now, while recording, I don't see my face here. But I know that due to the settings, my face will be appearing this part of the screen. When you'll be seeing the video, you will be actually seeing that I am actually, you know, pointing you to the actual, you know, image here. But right now, see, believe me, while recording, I don't see anything, my face here. What I see is C colon slash C programs slash some if and all and some other stuff here. Okay. Okay. Let me first. So for that reason, what I want is I want to clear the screen so that my output goes up. And how did I clear the screen? CLS. And enter, okay? CLS, press enter. It will clear your output screen. Okay, now let's come back to the point of inconvenience, okay? Now, why is it inconvenient? You see here, if I execute the program, you see the cursor is simply blinking here. Now, see, as a programmer, you are the programmer, you wrote the code, so you know that here you have to enter two numbers. But when you write a program, you don't write the program only for you. You write the program for some other users. Other people will use the program. You just assume the program that runs behind the ATM screen, okay? And if you see that, okay, that you go to the ATM and without displaying like enter the PIN number, simply the cursor is blinking there, how will you know what you have to enter? You will, like the programmer who wrote that ATM machine program, certainly he knows that here at this place, the user is expected to enter the PIN number. But you know, you got the point. Programmer mostly, that particular programmer certainly, he might have used that ATM machine maybe once or twice or maybe a few numbers of time. For him, it will not be a problem, assuming he doesn't forget. But for the rest of the world, certainly it's a problem. It's inconvenient, isn't it? So for that reason, along with that, like that blinking cursor there in the ATM machine, along with the space where you can type something, you see a message also, like what you have to enter. Say, for example, enter PIN number or whatever it is that it is expecting you to type there, right? The same way here also in a C program. Now, instead of like blinking the cursor, simply the cursor blinks here means what? We don't know as a user. We don't know what we have to do. Do I have to write here hello world or something and press enter? The sum is 120. From where it got 120? Yes, hey, because of these 90 and 30. It just rejected the input actually. See here? Those are something you have to worry about, okay? But anyhow, my point is that yes, instead of blinking the cursor here, like if we it is a good idea that we actually display some message to the user also. So for that reason, what we'll be doing is we'll be writing here a printf statement. Okay, we know like here actually before waiting for the user, before asking the user, like, you know, before actually waiting for the user to enter the number, first the program will ask the user, okay, you please enter the number, and then it will wait. Got it? Now that is, now suppose you go to some, you need the pen from a person, okay? So if you go to the person and you just simply sit nearby him, he will never know that he has to give you the pen, or you are in the need of a pen to write something there. So what you do first, you go to the person, sir, may I have your pen, please? And then you wait there. If the person is generous enough, he will give you the pen. Otherwise, he will show you some indication, some facial expression or something he will do, from where you will come to know, okay, this is not the right person to ask a pen for. Same thing here also in a program. Like whenever you are writing a program, wherever you want your program to wait for the user to accept, to enter some number, there, just before writing the scanf, you will always write a printf statement, okay? So here, what am I going to do is enter two numbers. A convenient message. I mean, what you are expecting the user to enter, that thing you will write here in printf statement. Now see, just by writing this printf, our output will actually enhance a lot. So I go there and I run the program. You can see enter two numbers here. Now it is waiting. If I see these things now, enter two numbers, now I know, okay, I have to enter two numbers there. So two numbers. So by default, what typically what people will do is they will type the first number, enter, and the second number, enter. So now sum is 108. So that is one way of doing the thing. Or what you can do is, instead of displaying only one message, like I need your pen and I need your mobile phone also to make a call. Okay, so I need your pen, I need your mobile phone, and I need your some other thing that you want to ask. I need the key of your car. Quite dangerous, right? You cannot go to a stranger and ask the key of his or her car. But anyhow, so instead of asking all the things in a single go, what you can do is you can ask it like one by one. Sir, may I have your pen? Okay, the pen you received, you can again ask like, sir, may I have your, what I said, the smartphone or whatever. And once he gives you the smartphone, sir, may I have your the key of your car? Nobody will give you, okay? I'm just giving you an analogous example, that's all. Nobody will give you, obviously nobody will. The pen people will give you, other than that, the smartphone and the car, obviously, don't expect. Just kidding. Now, the thing is, here, enter two numbers. Instead of writing it this way, what you can do is, you can do it in this way. Enter the, you can write the same program in this way also. Enter the first number. And you accept, instead of accepting one number, instead of accepting two numbers, you accept only one number here in this way. Enter the first number, wait for the program will wait for the user to enter the number. As soon as the user enters the number, you repeat the same thing now for the second number. So enter the second number and then scanf percentage the address of B. Okay, done. So this is another way of doing the same thing. Okay, if you now run the program, I guess it will be more user friendly. Now again, as I said, no, it will actually, my face will be here, so certainly you will not be able to see it. So let me clear the screen and run the program once again. Run the code. Enter the first number. Here I have entered the first number as say 23. Press enter. Now enter the second number. I enter the number as 45. Done, and the sum is 68.000. Got it? Okay, so I guess the people got the idea how to use scanf. And you see here, usually you see printf statement coming just before scanf statement, but do not you think that it is the demand of the syntax? It is not the demand of the syntax, it is the demand of the situation, sort of. Okay, like scanf will simply wait there for the user to enter something from the keyboard. So when you are actually, when your program is waiting for something, your program at the same time, if it displays some messages or some hint to the user like what it is actually waiting for, it's a good idea. And that's why in most of the times, whenever you're seeing a scanf, just before it, usually you see a printf statement. But again, I want to make you people remember or realize the fact that it is not the need of the syntax, or you know, it's just, as I said, no, it is the nature of the problem, or sort of it's the demand of the situation, sort of. Okay guys, then you people have learned like how to accept numbers from the keyboard using this scanf statement. Different types of number you can take. You can consider integer. You can take integers from the keyboard. You can take floating point numbers. Same way you can take characters and long floating point numbers. There are some other data types also which I have not said you, but I suggested you one book there, right? So you read the book, you follow the book. So if you know how to use these basic data types, how to deal with it, how to write program using these basic data types, then certainly you'll be knowing automatically how to use those stuff there. Okay, so don't need to worry much about the rest of the things. So if you understand this, then certainly you can assume that you have understood those things also. It's just a matter of like opening the book, reading those details. Like when you prepare for the exam or something, then certainly you have to go through those details, right? But I promise you, if you understand this, then going through those details and uploading it in your brain will not take much time actually. Okay. Okay guys, then if you have understood up to this point, I guess that much only in this part of the video. I could have shown you how to accept one character from the keyboard. Say for example, here itself, I write a program that that accepts one character from the keyboard. So for that reason, I'm declaring character variable says C, and there I first display the user, like, so that, you know, the user knows, like, enter a character from the keyboard, okay? Enter a character. So that's all. And let's say I want the cursor to blink in the next line, so I'm writing there a new line, and then I'm writing here scanf, and then what I want to accept, I want to accept a character, so I'll be writing %c, and then there I'll be writing the address of the variable where I want this type character to go. I want this type character to go to this variable c, so I'll be writing here address of the variable c. That's all. And suppose I want to display it on the screen. What is the character that the user type? So I'll be writing here printf, and then %c is the character type by you. Okay, that's all. Now, since I have written here %c, I mean see here this printf statement. I typed the printf statement in this way. Okay. So since I typed the printf statement in this way, how many format specifiers I have used here? One. So one hole will be created. So obviously I have to specify a list of values that will fill the hole. One hole, it means one value. What value it is? Whatever it is, the value of the variable C. That's all. I run this program. You can see run the code, and you can see enter a character here. And there I type, see here, because of this new line, now the cursor is coming to this point. Here I have to enter a character. So for example, I write here X and I press enter. So it will show you X is the character typed by you. So that is how you take input in a C program. I guess the people understood the concept here, understood like what is a scanf function, this very, very dangerous looking function. I mean, percentage is there, ampersand is there, I mean, you know, all this stuff. But now I think whenever you are seeing a scanf, it will not make you like, what is this? You will not feel like that. You'll be able to interpret it. Okay, this is taking one character, and that character will go to the variable C. And this ampersand symbol is coming as part of the syntax. And what does it mean? It just means that, okay, here you are not specifying the variable, actually. You're specifying the program here, actually, in that program, you're specifying actually the address of the variable C. Got it? This ampersand writing here, it is important as part of the syntax. You cannot omit it. Certainly, you have to write it. And the meaning of it, like it just gets the address of that particular variable. And why you have to write it that way? Because the scanf function is developed in that way only. Like whenever you are writing a scanf, where you want to store it, you have to specify the address of those variables, not the variable names only. So for that reason, you are writing it in this way. The details of these addresses, address and all this stuff, we'll be talking about, we'll be discussing those concepts certainly when we'll be talking about pointers. But for the time being, don't need to worry much about it, okay? Only thing is that you just need to know, okay, this is how a scanf is written. Whenever you want to accept input from the keyboard, you just write the scanf statement in this way. Based on the type of data, you have to change the format specifiers, and that's all. And then one last thing now, then you might be thinking, what if we want to, we know like when we have to accept one character, it can be done, one integer, it can be done, one floating point number or double number, it can be done. But what if, suppose a program is there and it has to accept the name of a person, right? Now, as I said in my previous video also, this name of a person, it is not a specific data type. I mean, it is not a basic data type, you know. It is a string. And how to accept string from the keyboard, that is quite easy. I mean, you can use the format specifier %s, okay? But what I want to tell you is that in this part of the video, I'll not get into the details of string and how to accept string from the keyboard, okay? I request you people just, first try to understand these few things in a clear-cut way. I mean, you know the things in details. And then whenever we'll be discussing about string, there again, I'll tell you how you use scanf actually to read a string from the keyboard and process the string, okay? So keep that thing for the future part of the video. So in this part of the video, I just only told you like how to use scanf to read input, and more specifically inputs of type integer, floating point number, character, and double, and the different ways of, you know, writing this scanf function. Got it? Okay. One more thing actually I have to tell you, and that thing is that, see, you remember like this scanf function is to read input from the keyboard. It is to read input from the keyboard and store the input in a program variable. And the printf function is to display something on the screen. Okay, so that's the reason. See, you remember that I said, you say, for example, to discuss this point, let me make use of this example. So you have these two variables A and B, and you want to accept the value of this variable A and B from the keyboard. So you can write here scanf, and then you can write here, I said you have to write only a string of address of A and address of B. You have to write only a string of format specifiers here, like %d. I said you not to write space, not to write comma, and not to write anything else. See, the printf statement is different from scanf statement. See, had it been in printf, you usually write along with the format specifiers, you write it in this way, like say new line character, the sum is %d and then comma, say 34, like that. See, along with the format specifiers, you also usually you write something else also, like some other texts also, which are not like format specifiers. In printf it is allowed because the task of printf is to display things on the screen. So whatever it is that you want to display, you have to write, you must have to write. Printf should accept those things. But the task of scanf is not to display anything on the screen. So writing anything here is meaningless because it is anyhow not going to display anything on the screen. So don't expect like enter a number will display enter a number on the screen. See, you are actually writing a scanf statement, not a printf. Whenever you are writing a scanf statement, it will not going to display anything on the screen. So there is no point of writing anything there. Logically, if you think, there is no point of writing anything there in this scanf statement. And then this comma part. Like, since it is a string, I mean, it is, as soon as you write %d, it knows that, okay, this is a %d, means it is one, like here, it has to accept one integer number. So there is no point of putting a comma there explicitly. Automatically, it can interpret, okay, %d and then d. Okay, it knows that it has to accept a number and it has to store that number where? In the variable a. So immediately after that, it will start, okay, now the next thing is again a %d. If you give a space, then it will not do any good. In fact, it will do things bad. Got the point? So no space, no comma, no something else in scanf. Only format specifiers. Got the point? That much only then I had to tell you. Okay. Now let's one final thing, huh? Let me tell you here. Say for example, enter. I write, say, even if I said you that you are not supposed to write anything there, but say I write here. Why this error is coming? Scanf, and where could be the problem here? It's missing. Okay. Enter. 2 numbers. I write it. And I write it there. Even if I said that you're not supposed to write, suppose some people wrote it in this way. Now see, since this scanf function, the syntax is saying that you need to specify the first part as integer, and first part as string. The second part of the input is a list of addresses of variables. Okay? So that way, syntax-wise, you had to specify a string and you're specifying the string. Okay? So syntax-wise, this program is not wrong. If you execute, it means it will not, the compiler is not going to show you any error message. It will simply execute your program. I mean, it will wait for you to enter something from the keyboard because of these two format specifiers there. Okay. So suppose now you try to enter, say 12 and enter. The sum is 34. It is coming like 34 from somewhere. See, it is not behaving the way it should behave. Okay, it's a logical error some way. So why is it happening? Because you wrote these extra few things there which you were not supposed to write. So for that reason, this program is sort of behaving in a awkward way. Got it? Now, say, even if you wrote this thing, you can actually make this program work. What if you want this program to work properly, what you have to do is, say, for example, I execute this program and then enter two numbers. So what you have to do is, you have to actually, to make this program work, you have to type all the extra things that you typed in the program, in the scanf statement, you have to type them as it is when you specify the input. What I mean is, say enter, E-N-T-E-R, enter, 2, space, N-U-M-B-E-R-S, then colon, then you enter a number, say 12, okay? I enter, now it is sort of behaving properly. I enter the other number, 23, done. The sum is 34 coming here. Got the point? This line is showing you the sum is 34. Okay? See, the previous case, if I execute it again, I enter the first number 12 and press enter. Immediately, it is showing me 34. That way, it is wrong, isn't it? Because it should have waited for me to enter two numbers. Got the point? And why this problem is coming? Because of these extra text that you write. So, if you type some extra text in your scanf statement, then while giving input, when you run the program, when you give input, okay, that time you have to mention those extra text as it is, which is quite difficult because as a programmer, you might know what are the extra text, but as a user, when I use this program for actual purpose, then certainly I'll not know what are the things that you type inside this scanf function, right? So, moral of the story is never use them. That's the moral of the story. Never use even a comma. If you write a comma here, then if you run the program, obviously, it will be executed, no problem with that. Only thing is that it will behave in an awkward way. I mean, it will not behave the way it should behave, okay? It will not behave in an expected way. So, if you want this program to work fine while giving the input, since you wrote this comma extra here, after this first percentage D, what you have to do is, you first have to write 12, then explicitly you have to write the comma. And then you press enter, it will wait. Now it will behave properly. The other number will be accepted and done. Got the point? So those extra things, if you write in scanf, then you have to, while giving input, you have to also specify those extra things in the same order, in the same place where they were written in the scanf function. Certainly, that is something that nobody would like to do. So for that reason, the good idea is that nobody writes anything inside this scanf function except format specifiers, that too, one after another. Got the point? Okay, guys, then that much only I had to tell you about this scanf function. If you have understood up to this point, then I guess you people now are ready, I mean, to use the scanf function. You are, you'll be able to use this scanf function whenever you feel like. You got the point? But then also, if you have any queries or if you have any doubts or anything in your mind, then you please let me know it in the comment section. Say, any sort of doubt or anything, or you want me to create a video on a specific topic, then also that also you can, you know, that you can mention it in the comment section. And also I'm trying to upgrade the quality of my videos. Like, how should I deliver the content? You know, I try to deliver the content in the form of a story. Like, I tell you the story, the background of the things, and then, you know, I mention the important points there somewhere, right? So that way, when you are actually seeing my videos to learn something, you have to devote some amount of time, say 1 hour for one particular video. Yes, certainly, it's not, these videos are certainly not for those people who is preparing for the exam just before the exam. Certainly, this is not going to work. But what I feel is that when learning should be, you should learn things in a relaxed mode. You know, you are looking at the videos, some things are told to you, and you listen to them with patience, like, okay, I have time, I have plenty of time, actually. And, you know, so that way learning should happen, so that you remember those things for a long period of time, and you understand the thing, you give enough time to your brain to actually, you know, grasp the idea, digest the idea and all, okay? And so that's how I try to sort of deliver the content in this fashion. So, but then also, I am open to all sort of suggestions to improve the quality of my videos. I need your suggestion, I need your support, and all these things I need. So for that reason, you guys please comment. If you like the video, write some comment so that other people who are looking for such videos, for them these videos becomes useful. Okay, and write the comments only when, yeah, that's a genuine request. Write the comments only when you feel like it. Is not that, you know, for no reason you are writing the comment. If you're feeling like, okay, this video could be useful for some other people, then you write a comment there, and that way certainly your comment will be meaningful for some other people. Okay guys, then that's not only in this part of the video. See you guys with some new content in the next part of the video. Till then, have a nice day.